since Jesus came to my heart. What? Saints and friends.
Good morning.
How are you this morning?
We're good.
Yes, I'm still hurting, but I'm back. My back just acts up when it wants to, so it shut me down last week. This time last week, I was horizontal. I'm back to vertical. I'm glad to be here. Good to see you. We're closing in on the end of the year, 2023. Approaching the day that we celebrate the birthday of God's only begotten Son, Jesus Jesus the Christ child. Let us stand together. For this is the day that the Lord hath made. We are to rejoice and be glad. Praise God from whom all blessings flow.
To call at area code 916-961-6631. Also, please join us for coffee and refreshments on the other side of the wall after our service for fellowship. We will be collecting all sorts of items for the loaves and fishes stockings. If you have something and for some reason you didn't bring it, give me a call at home. I'm in the directory, and give me a call and I'll help get them, because I'll be taking them probably on the 22nd. Thank you, and we will light our Advent candle.
Are we doing Advent in Spanish or not?
I don't have. When God's people were surrounded by hardship, suffering, and grief, Isaiah proclaimed, "The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me. He has sent me to bring good news to the oppressed, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to captives and release to the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn, to provide for all those who mourn in Zion, to give them a garland instead of ashes, the oil of gladness instead of mourning, the mantle of praise instead of a faint spirit."
We come today as people who are also surrounded by suffering and grief, and yet the Spirit hovers among us, tending and anointing, inspiring freedom where there is captivity, declaring blessings in places of the world that has cursed, and ignited fierce joy where mourning and heartache prevail.
We wait as people who experience hardship and pain, yet we are called to witness to the persistent joy that sustains our life as God's people.
We light these candles as signs of our shocking hope, just peace, and fierce joy. May our lives shine with the fierce, tenacious joy of the light who lives in our hearts as we wait and work for the coming of God's kingdom on earth as it is in heaven. Amen.
Candle, candle, light the way.
remain standing. We will open up our service with opening hymn 117 in our red hymnals. O God, our help in ages past.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. We are getting closer and closer to the day in which we celebrate the birth of Jesus Christ. And I'm so glad to see each and every one of you. You look beautiful out there. Amen. Amen. You are so wonderful and so beautiful. And it is certainly good to see our friends. I had to make some copies in Espanol, and so we are so glad that they are here, and so we praise God for them. Amen. Amen. Danny and Freddie Marr and yes. Jose just walked in. All right. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. I have a sermon for you, Jose. And so I'll give it to you in just a moment. Amen. So glad to see that you are here. Amen. And it seems like we have some visitors, and I certainly want to, I don't want to embarrass them, but if they would just give us their name and anything else they'd like to say. But don't feel embarrassed. We're all friends. We're all loving people, and so all family.
Okay. I'm Vinita Mallory. This is my husband Calvin, and our wee little one record goes to the little
Oh, praise God. It is so good. It is so good to have you. Amen. It is so good. Yes, I know Sue will be happy to know that you are here. And so we just praise God for your presence, and we pray that our services will be spiritually rewarding and that you will indeed come back to worship with us. Amen. Jose, if you could come, I want to give you your copy of the sermon.
Takes a lot of work to do this, to translate it.
Well, let us continue our worship service with our prayer hymn, How Great Thou Art. Thank you.
is the time for prayer, and God's field is in the prayer answering business. I'm a living witness. How many believe that God still answers prayer? Give him a wave offering. Yes, yes, yes. He's greatly to be praised. It says that the prayer of the righteous availeth much. And we thank you for your prayers, and folks all over the world still need our prayers. During this season that we should be celebrating the birthday of Jesus, there are yet people suffering everywhere. So I'm sure you're like me. I don't wake up and think it's for granted. I'm glad when I can get up in the morning and look in the mirror and see it's me. Because we don't have to wake up, you know that, don't you? There are folk that rested last night that did not wake up this morning. So I'm glad about it. I'm glad that I can wake up, I recognize who I see in the mirror, and I thank God for his goodness and his mercy and his grace. Don't have to be here. But what for him being on our side, where would you and I be today? So we thank God. We thank God. We thank God. He's still meeting our every need. We look over our prayer list, and God is still touching the needs of those on our prayer list. He's still remembering the family of Sister Alma Andrews, family Raven Stenbeck, and Nancy Kay's sister Wendy in Southern California. I know she's still doing and progressing well. Bill is still here with us. Give me a wave, Bill. God bless you, man. God bless you. God bless you. Ada R., Ben C., Sharon J., Betty S. and her granddaughter, Raven. Remember Sue Lee and Ruth G. and Linda R., Loretta D. Still thank God for tenderly touching the body of Brother Paul, Sister Carol, who is by his side 24/7. We thank you for Tony, Wendy's son, Eric, Janine's son, and husband now. Continue to thank you for the prayers offered up for Roseanne's sister Michelle, Lynn G., husband Roy, and continue special prayers for Cameron. He rung the bell, and we know that God is still a miracle working God. Continue prayer for Sherry J.'s brother Mark, John Cheryl R.'s niece, and free family lost Barry Williams, her cousin. Continue to remember Dave's mother and Kathy's mother. Remember Renee and Ruby, Patty and Betty S.'s granddaughter. Continue to remember Ida. I think she had minor surgery. I thought I said Lida. Okay. And let's remember her in her recovery. Tend to remember our oldest son for healing, Charles Dixon Laws. He lives in the Bay Area. And if we've missed anybody, you have somebody that needs to be remembered in prayer. God knows their name and where they are. Just wave. If you have somebody that you want us to remember, want God to remember, knowing that he will take care of everything. Praise his holy name. Thank God. Songwriter says, when Christ shall come the shout of acclamation and takes me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and proclaim there, my God, how great thou art. Oh Lord, we come to you this morning knowing that you're the greatest. We thank you for being everywhere that we are. And we come to you, O Lord, thanking you for what you've already done. We believe you for what you're going to do. We have confidence that as we ask anything in your name, it shall be granted unto us. So God, we thank you for the prayer that you've answered thus far. When we needed you, you were always there, omnipresent. You're everywhere we are, we thank you for it. We thank you, Lord, that you're still in the healing business. You touch our bodies as our bodies break down. You still give us strength. You give us vitality. You give us energy. You give us a desire to want to keep going. While we look to the hills, we come with all of our help, knowing that our help cometh from you. And we could not make it without you, Lord. So we thank you this morning that you brought us together as a family of believers, knowing, oh God, that you're in the midst of us. Where two or three have gathered in your name, you have promised to be here. And we sense your presence, and we thank you for it. Hallelujah. We thank you, oh God, that as we come to this corporate worship experience, we come, oh Lord, knowing that there are those suffering, those that are in worse situation than we are. So we don't look and think that we're greater than others, but we humble ourselves and allow your God to melt us and to mold us, fill us and to use us for your purposes. And we thank you for it. We're willing, oh God, to do what you say do. Go where you say go. Say what you tell us to say. And we thank you. We thank you, Lord, that you're able to go into the hospital rooms. You're able to go into the convalescent centers. You're even able to go into the jail cells and able to deliver, able to talk, able to speak, able to somehow, Lord, give us a hope that we will come more better because of your presence in our lives. So we thank you and believe you, O God, for continued blessings in our name. We thank you, Lord, that you're able to come to this place. And as we come worshiping you in the spirit of truth, that we also come believing that there's a word to be said in our behalf. A word to be said. So when we leave this place, we can say, I was glad when it said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. We thank you. We thank you, O God, for our pastor. We believe you for a fresh word from heaven this morning. We believe you, O God, that you have something very special to share with us through the vessel of our pastor. We believe you for liberating, delivering, setting us free, making us, O God, more better because of your presence. And we thank you again and again and again. Continue to be with us, and we thank you for our music department, praise team, our musicians. Thank you for the usher. Thank you for everybody that's in this place. For you are somebody special in the eyesight of the Lord. And so we thank you. Thank you. And thank you some more. Be with us now, God, as we continue this time to worship. In your name we pray the prayer that you taught us how to pray. Our Father, which art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come,
thy will be done on earth
as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread,
and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, to deliver us from evil. For thine is
the kingdom, the power, and the glory
forever. Amen. Amen.
Children are here. Praise
God. Scripture today, Old Testament scripture, is from Isaiah 61, verses 1 through 4. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me. He has sent me to bring good news to the oppressed, to bind the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and release to the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn, to provide for those who mourn in Zion, to give them a garland instead of ashes, the oil of gladness instead of mourning, the mantle of praise instead of a faint spirit. They will be called oaks of righteousness, the planting of the Lord to display his glory. This is
praise God. New Testament lesson for the morning is found in Luke, first chapter 46, second part of 46 verse to the 56th verse. My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God, my Savior. For he has looked with favor on the lowliness of his servant. Surely from now on all generations will call me blessed. For the mighty one has done great things for me, and holy is his name. His mercy is for those who fear him from generation to generation. He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in the thoughts of their hearts. He has brought down the powerful from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy, according to the promise he made to our ancestors, to Abraham and to his descendants forever. And Mary remained with her for about 3 months and then returned to her home. God had a blessing for the reading of his word. Praise his name. The mighty hymn for the morning. Since Jesus. In a special treat this morning.
Yes, okay. You are.
We're going to sing the first verse and the chorus in English. Then we're going to listen. And those of us who know a little bit of Espanol can join the choral group here in singing the verse and the chorus in Espanol. And then we will close with the chorus in English. Okay, that follows. Praise God. Thank you. heart. Yes, not a hand clap of praise. Hallelujah. Praise his holy name.
Praise the Lord. It's always good. It's always good to do something different. And so we praise God for our friends, our family that is here with us. And we thank God for them. I'm sorry, I couldn't remember your name. I blame it on my age. Blame it on 78. Amen. Praise the Lord. Oh, gracious God, our Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for your goodness and your mercy and your loving kindness that is granted unto us. Spirit of the living God, fall fresh on us. Melt us and mold us and use us to your glory. And Father God, take me down into the deep hollows of your heart and your soul. In your mind, that you may speak through me in the mighty and powerful name of Jesus. Bless this waiting congregation, O God, and touch in the name of Jesus. We pray this in the mighty and powerful name of Jesus. Amen. My brothers and my sisters, most of us are familiar with the story of Mary and Joseph and the angel who appeared to the Virgin Mary. Imagine the shock as an angel greets her with, "The Lord favors you. The Lord is with you." This in itself makes the story hard for many people to believe. Angels don't just appear to anyone, no, but especially to a young woman in this particular time in Jewish culture. Mary was not a wealthy girl, nor was she an influential person. Why did God choose her? The angel tells her that she is going to have a baby, and this is not going to be any kind of kid. This is going to be the Messiah.
Hallelujah.
The Son of God. And I'm sure at first she was so overwhelmed that she was not sure what to believe. Now Mary knew about the prophesied Messiah, but I'm sure that she was shocked that she would be the one to give birth to him. What would her fiance, Joseph, say? She's a virgin. And what would all of the people in the community say? What is going to happen to me, I'm sure she wondered. They probably will stone me. However, as we look at Luke 1:38, Mary says, after the angel told her what would happen, "Be it unto me according to thy will." So I want to talk on the subject, "Lord, I'm available to you." Lord, I'm available to you. I can imagine when she said that, she touched heaven in her response. My siblings, I want us always to remember that God's desire is for us to become closer and closer to him, not away from him. And I know by experience that prayer does change things. Consequently, our prayers should also change our heart. And our heart should change the way we pray. That means that there should be some evidence of a change in us. Yes. Most of the time, we are asking for a situation in our lives to change. But in reality, we are the ones that need to change. Yes, it's me, O Lord, standing in the need of prayer. Not my mother, not my father, not my sister or my brother. It's me standing in the need of prayer. Amen. For there is always something that we have to do for a situation to change. And you know, by the time that we come out of that particular situation, there will be some evidence of some kind of change, some kind of transformation that can be seen in our walk, our talk, our actions, to indicate that our will has become more in line with the will of God. So as we look at Mary in this very difficult time in her life, a time when she would be ostracized by the community, a time when she could be dumped by her fiancé, a time when she could have been stoned and killed, all for becoming pregnant outside of marriage. For who would believe that story? That an angel named Gabriel came to her, a peasant girl from Nazareth, a poor backwater village in the shadow of the much wealthier town of Sepphoris, to tell her that she was highly chosen and favored by God, and that she would miraculously conceive and bear a son, and she will name him Jesus. And when she asked the angel, "How will this be, since she has never been with a man?" the angel responded, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the Spirit of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, this child will be holy." My God, how could anyone believe such a thing? Oh, but I tell you, she trusted and she believed, despite what Joseph might think. But praise be to God, when the angel appeared to Joseph, he also believed God, in spite of what the community or anyone else thought. They both trusted and they believed in God's promise. That's why this song, I'm not going to sing it, "I'm Available to You," keeps ringing in my ears. Lord, I am available to you, in spite of the fact that I might not quite understand everything that is happening in my life, in spite of what it might look like in the natural, I'm putting my faith in God no matter what the people might say or do. My mind, my body, soul, spirit is totally entwined with you, Lord. I'm available to be used by you, God. And so as we celebrate this Advent season, we're looking for a transformation in ourselves, that we might empty ourselves with ourselves and fill ourselves with Jesus. Yeah. The angel also tells Mary that her cousin Elizabeth, in her old age, 88 years old, is also pregnant, which is a miracle in itself. You know, God puts people in our lives to help us walk through stuff. Mary was so excited about this new revelation that she hurried to the hill country of Judea, where she entered Zechariah's home and greeted Elizabeth, who proclaimed, as soon as Mary's greetings reached her ears, "The baby's her baby's womb leaped up for joy. You see, Elizabeth was so inspired that she was given a divine utterance. And even the baby, John, felt the power in her womb and confirmed the coming of Jesus and was a witness to his ministry by leaping in his mother's womb. You see, God said he would fill the Holy Spirit in her womb. So when preparation meets purpose, your spirit will leap within you. Oh, the blessing of John, even in his mother's womb at the sound of Mary's greeting. Not only was Elizabeth given this gift of inspired utterance, but John was filled with the power from on high and was the first to give witness to the presence of the coming Messiah in his mother's womb. Then in a loud voice, Elizabeth exclaimed, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the child you will bear. But why am I so favored that the mother of my Lord should come to me? Blessed is she who has believed what the Lord has said to her will be accomplished." So not only do you become enthusiastic, but you have a promise from God that you would be blessed because you believed what God said. Then Mary sang a song. She said, "My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has looked with favor on the lowliness of his servant. Surely from now on all generations will call me blessed, for the Mighty One has done great things for me, and holy is his name. His mercy is for those who fear him from generation to generation. He has shown his strength with his arms. He has scattered the proud in the thoughts of their hearts. He has brought down the powerful from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich empty away. He has helped his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy, according to the promise he made to our ancestors, to Abraham and to his descendants forever." And Mary stayed with her for about 3 months and then returned home. But I want us to know that during this time, Judea was a vassal or subservient state in Rome. Augustus Caesar was emperor and gave watch over Herod, who acted as king, and the people scrambled to make a living. Poverty was all around and sickness was common. There was no justice anywhere to be found. Oppression and depression was the order of the day. Kind of sounds familiar, doesn't it? To make things worse, the prophets were silent. And for 400 years, the question had been, where is the Messiah? For many, it was the worst of times. Curiously, there were some religious stargazers in Persia who saw it differently. They had observed an unusual planetary alignment, making the brightest star they had ever seen. For them, it was an omen, a good omen, signifying the birth of a world leader. But even though these wise men were from another land and pagan religion, they knew that something good was happening, and they recognized that a bad time was turning into a good time. I think that tells us a lot about how people were feeling when the news began to break across ancient Near East that God was at last sending the long-promised Messiah. In the first two chapters alone in Luke's gospel, He records four different songs as part of the Good News. These songs are songs of faith and capture the great joy of the people surrounding the birth of Jesus Christ. The first of these songs of joy is placed on the lips of Jesus' mother. When Mary pours out from her mouth 10 days after the visit from the angel Gabriel as she visited her cousin Elizabeth. As Mary celebrates her divine pregnancy, she is proclaiming the mighty works of God in turning established order on its head in favor of the poor and more marginalized. People just like Mary, she is celebrating the fact that the last shall now be first because God had looked on the lowliness of servants with extravagant blessings of love. Even though Mary found herself in the midst of trying circumstances, even though she was a very small fish in a big pond, she is able to say, "The Mighty One has done great things for me." And Mary not only knows the depths of her being, the fulfillment of God's promises, and in response to the people's hopes and dreams, that all generations will be blessed, just as she had been blessed with sure hopes and dreams now becoming a reality. How can Mary keep from singing, "My soul magnifies the Lord, for he has done great things. I'm available to you." Mm-hmm. Oh, I know that God was smiling down at her. But Mary's song was not only about herself, for after lifting up God's work in her own life, Mary continues the song with an anticipatory pray of all that God will do for his people through the son she is about to bear. Through her song, Mary announces for the first time in Luke's gospel the radical revolution that God is about to begin in the person of Jesus Christ. It has prompted many to refer to Mary as the first disciple of the gospel. Yes, interesting. The first disciple of Jesus Christ, and for good reason, for Mary gives a summary, overview of all that God will accomplish in the life, ministry, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. It is certainly nothing short of a complete revolution. She knew her theology better than the Pharisees and the Sadducees, and some folks even today. Oh, when we focus on the things that the disciple Mary says, you will notice that there are some folks that disregard what the gospel is all about. We hear every day folks who have the nerve to call themselves Christians on the television set, in the legislature, and the state, who leave out what? Love. Love. When God is love. Who leaves out justice when God is a God of justice. Who leaves out liberation when Jesus is our liberator. God is not happy with the oppression of the widow or the orphan or the least, the lost, and the left out. That's why folks back in the day would say, "Everybody talking about love, everybody talking about heaven ain't going there." But let us consider all that God was up to in the world that Mary was so excited about. She says, "He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered those with arrogant thoughts and proud inclinations." Because you know, pride is a terrible thing. A colleague of mine once said, "I know that God considers all sin equally, but if there's one sin that is really worse than any other, I think it's pride." You have all heard the expression, pride goes before the fall. Pride can lead folks to do so many awful things to make folks lose sight of what is more important in life. Pride can cause folks to think they are better than they really are, which can make folks look with judgment upon others for any reason, skin color, gender, race, etc., whom they consider as less than themselves. And at its worst, pride can lead folks to believe that they have no need for God. So Mary now declares that God in Christ Jesus ends pride. Because when folks remember that any blessing we experience, any accomplishment we enjoy is the result of God and his grace shown to us through Jesus Christ. So there is no reason for anybody to be proud. It's all about God, and God is the one who blesses us. Mary truly celebrates that God brings down the powerful from their thrones and lifts up the lowly. Mary has already learned firsthand that God didn't go to Herod's castle to impregnate one of Herod's many wealthy wives with his son, and God went to a tiny village to an unwed peasant girl to carry the Messiah. It was the beginning of God's upending of every social and political structure that we as humans even try to put in place so that we can maintain power for ourselves while keeping others oppressed. This is a major declaration about who God is, because the simple truth of the matter is that if we are all being honest, we will see that it is not just politicians and leaders who maintain such structures, but it is also sometimes us individuals. Yeah. But anyway, as I get ready to close and get happy all by myself, I want to point out the fact that I will forever, always make myself available to God. As I get back to Mary, when the angel said, "Nothing is impossible with God," Mary simply replied, "Behold, your servant of the Lord. I will gladly make myself available. I will gladly submit to your will. I will be whatever you want me to be, Lord." Yes. Church, will you join me in stating each day by day, saying, "Behold, your servant of the Lord, be it unto me according to your will. Fill me with your Holy Spirit." Lord, more than anything else, I want Jesus to show up in my life. I'm available to you, Lord. Use me, make me, break me. I give my all to you. Lord, I'm available to you. My will I give to you. I'll do what you say. Use me, Lord. I ain't going there. But to show someone the way and enable me to say my storage is empty and I am available to you. Yes, I'm giving back to you all the tools you have given to me, my hands, my ears, my voice, my eyes, so you can use them as you please. I have emptied out my cup so that you can fill me up. Amen. Now I'm free, just as you want me to be. My storage is empty, and I am available to you. And do you know what happens? We begin to see something miraculously happening in our lives. The Spirit of the Lord comes upon us, The Spirit of the Lord. Yes, the Spirit of the Lord, the source of wisdom that enables us to think God thoughts after him. The Spirit of the Lord, understanding that helps us understand his thoughts. The Spirit of counsel that helps us to choose the right course for godliness. The Spirit of strength that empowers us to do God's will in our lives. The Spirit of knowledge that sees God through manifestations in our lives. The Spirit of fear, which is love, of walking in his ways. There's no one greater than our God, no one bigger, no one that is more powerful. If our greatest need was for more information, God would have sent an educator. If our greatest need was technology, God would have sent a scientist. If our greatest need was for money, God would have sent an economist. If our greatest need was pleasure, God would have sent an entertainer. But our greatest need was for forgiveness and is for forgiveness. So God sent a sovereign forgiver. His ways are higher. His thoughts are loftier. No one ever before or thought throughout all eternity will ever compare to him. The songwriter says, "Sovereign Lord, my Lord, my God is sovereign. He can do whatever he wants to do, whenever he wants to do it. God can do what he wants to do. Who am I to question his wisdom? I am nothing. Who am I to question God's judgment? I am nothing. Who am I to be offended by his ways, by word he allows to be? I must realize that my God is sovereign. God can do whatever he wants to do, whenever he wants to do it. Because he's sovereign. God is God. And like Mary, I say, be it unto me according to your way, according to your word. Lord, I am available to you." Amen. Blessed are those who hear the word and do it. My brothers and my sisters, at this time of Advent, I believe that one of the best things that we can do, if we haven't accepted Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, this is your opportunity. Romans 10:9 says, if you confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that Jesus Christ lived, died, and rose from the dead, you shall be saved. And there's a simple prayer that you can pray to God. Lord, I'm a sinner. Now I want to change my life. So Lord, I want you to come into my heart, come into my mind, my spirit, my soul, and lead me and guide me. And I promise to serve you for the rest of my life. Thank you, Lord, for saving me. Thank you, Lord, for forgiving me and giving me your great salvation. The word says that if you pray, have prayed this prayer, you are now saved. So now you need to find a church home where you can work out your own salvation. So we invite you to Fair Oaks United Methodist Church, a loving church. A church that will embrace you. A church that will love you. So if there's anyone watching online, all you have to do is to call us at 916-961-6631. And we will pray with you, we will lead you and guide you into the way of life. We look forward to hearing from you. And we pray God's blessings upon you during this time of Advent and always. Amen. So now we come to the time of real celebration. It's a celebratory thing when we can give back to God. For all that He has done for us. So as the usher comes, we thank you for your gifts and your tithes and your offerings to be used for the upbuilding of God's church and kingdom. Gracious God, our Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for these gifts and offerings to be used for the upbuilding of our church and kingdom. Bless the givers, O God. Bless those who wanted but were unable to. We thank you for those who give online, those who send through the mail. We thank you, O God. And now we ask that you will bless 101,000-fold both in this offering and also in our own personal coffers. We thank you, God, and we give you praise, we give you honor, we give you glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. And bless you, Adrian, and bless you, and bless you, and bless you, and bless you. bless you, and bless you. And bless you, and bless you, and bless you, and bless you, and bless you. Okay? And bless you, and you, and bless you, and you, and you, and you. Thank you, thank you, thank you. In the name of Jesus, we pray and let us go out into the world, helping the poor, supporting the weak, returning no evil for evil. And may the love of God, the graciousness of our Savior Jesus Christ, and the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit bless and rule in our lives this time and forevermore. And all the people said, amen. 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 Thank you. Thank you.